Hey, Bill Nye, the science guy here.
This is Salman Rushdie.
Hi, this is Julia Sweeney.
I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson.
This is Theo Wilson.
Hi, this is Dar Williams.
I'm Mr. Deity, and you're listening to the Humanist Hour. I command you to listen now, or I will smite you.
Yes, I am a sound scientist. Came to evaluate the evidence on a closed case, highly classified, confidential, in a race against the clock.
Hi, listeners. I'm Jes Constantine.
And I'm Todd Stiefel. Welcome to the Humanist Hour podcast, the official podcast of the American Humanist Association.
Humanism is the life stance that we can be good without a belief in God or the supernatural. Todd, how are things?
Awesome.
That's good.
Life is good right now.
Life is good right now. I got to take a little road trip, so I'm
Ooh, where'd you go? Psyched.
I went to Cranston, Rhode Island, and That's all I have to say.
Cranston rings a bell for a variety of reasons.
Mm-hmm. Quaint little town in Rhode Island, but there's a lot of energy there. I can tell you that right now.
You'd think in Rhode Island it would be a relatively liberal town, but from what I hear, it's not so liberal, is it?
Not so much. At least not as far as the school administration at Cranston High School West goes.
Refresh my memory again. I believe there's a student there who's one heck of an activist.
Yeah, absolutely. So Jessica Alquist is her name, and she sued her school, Cranston High School West, because there is a prayer banner hanging up in the wall, or it's a mural, I should say.
You mean there was?
No, it's actually still there. It's just covered with tarp right now. It's still hanging up.
Cute.
Mm-hmm. I like just draw more attention to it by putting tarp over it. But anyway, so she won a case ruling that the school had to take the banner down because it was a violation of the First Amendment for Jessica. So, and other students who don't believe in the Holy Father or Heavenly Father, I believe was the phrasing of the opening line of the school prayer. So I went to Cranston, Rhode Island during just a couple of days ago because the school committee was meeting to decide if they were going to appeal the decision that, you know, that the school, they're fighting basically because they want to keep the banner up. And so they wanted to hear from residents and students and teachers from Cranston before they made their decision. And it was quite an experience, and I'm glad that I was there.
The good news here is that the Cranston School Committee did the right thing and voted not to appeal this. And so the banner is going to come down and there will no longer be an official school prayer at Cranston High School West. But what gets particularly interesting is some of the things that were said there and the theatrics going on at the event. And we're going to play some of those clips that Jes got on the show later on. But first, we got a couple other cool things to talk about before we get to some of the audio highlights from the day of festivities.
So, Todd, I was wondering if you had done any purchasing of walking shoes recently.
Well, I'm getting my walking shoes ready. We've been working on something really cool for a long time. This has been a neat project that's been in the works for a while now, and it's finally come to fruition. I've been working with Foundation Beyond Belief and a whole bunch of groups in the movement to raise money for cancer. And we just announced this week that we have a partnership. We're going to be a national team partner, actually an international team partner, because this is for both Canada and the U.S. and people outside of those countries are able to help as well. But we're joining with the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society. And we're going to do something a little nutty. We are going to shoot to raise $1 million this year within our movement to fight cancer.
Wow. That's awesome, Todd. So how does it work?
Well, it's all based around their Light the Night walks, which there's about 185 of those in the US and Canada in the autumn of each year. And it's a full year fundraising program. And people can join teams, become fundraisers, ask family, friends, and you know, I think there's really no better way to be out as a humanist than by raising money for a great charity. You know, we are all aware that there's some discrimination out there and people often don't understand what we're about, but it's really hard to dislike someone or not show them the love when you're out there trying to raise money for fighting cancer.
Definitely. You know, yeah.
we might not agree with our neighbor's beliefs, but we can all agree that cancer is a plague. So these walks take place in the fall, and we're going to just start raising money now. And so the big thing we're doing right now, and for our listeners out there all over the country, and we're really hoping that you'll get out and go to the website and sign up for a team. Create a team in the name of your friends or in the name of one of your local groups, in the name of one of your AHA chapters or affiliates. And that's the first step, is we need people to form walking teams that'll take part in these like 2 to 3 mile walks and form the teams. And then we're going to need to recruit fundraisers, and then we're going to need to start bringing in a lot of donors. But people can also help just by donating straight to the team. Give money to the team. And what's cool is we have a matching challenge. So the first $500,000 is going to be matched dollar for dollar. So literally, we as a movement need to raise $500,000. And if we can do that, we hit the $1 million goal. So anything somebody raises, anything somebody donates, will all be matched dollar for dollar, which is pretty sweet.
Todd, where can people get their registration packets? How can they start teams?
All right. So all the best information is on the Foundation Beyond Belief website. And that has the links to the actual Light the Night website as well. So you can go to Foundation Beyond Belief. That's all one word. FoundationBeyondBelief.org/LLS-Light the Night. One word.
So Todd, who are the organizations that are helping to sort of put this thing together? You got an all-star cast.
Yeah. Movement has come together on this scale before, but usually for like a big event, like the Reason Rally, for example, coming up next month, March 24th, little plug.
Nice. Never heard anyone.
In DC. So that was a subliminal plug. But this is really a big grassroots effort where organizations are coming together to really promote their chapters and affiliates to get out, mobilize, and form teams. So American Humanist Association is one of them. They've been there with me working on this right from the beginning. And there's a whole bunch of other ones. So I'll try to rattle them off really fast. We've got American Atheists, Atheist Alliance of America, Camp Quest, Center for Inquiry, Centre for Inquiry Canada, Freedom from Religion Foundation, the Harvard Humanist Chaplaincy and their alumni groups, the Military Association of Atheists and Freethinkers, Secular Student Alliance, and United Core, United Coalition of Reason. Plus, we also just found out that the American Ethical Union and Society for Humanistic Judaism are joining as allies, and will be encouraging their chapters and societies and communities to join in as well. And then on top of all that, we actually have a couple of supporters that are joining in, and you know, that list is growing every day. But we've got so far the Richard Dawkins Foundation, Sam Harris's group Project Reason, and we also have JREF, the James Randi Educational Foundation.
That's amazing. I love it. I love to see all of the groups in this movement come together for something that's so important and for something that will show people what we really are all about.
Fun. I'm excited. I really am. This is going to be really cool for us as a movement. And I think it's going to be great to be out there and open and have people at these local events see us out there in our t-shirts, doing things they might not expect because they don't really know us. They don't understand us. They don't understand our values. And we'll be out there demonstrating and living by values that are, they're humanist values. They're secular values. And I think they're really the values most Americans share and people all over the world.
Yeah. This is one of those great opportunities that we talk about. People always, they classify us often by what we don't believe in. So this is a great opportunity for us to show something that we do believe in.
Exactly. Funding scientific research, education, compassionate services. Can you do any better than that? Can you leverage humanism anymore? So it's going to be really fun. And LLS has been an awesome partner so far. They've been really supportive and they've been great.
We have one more update. And this one's sort of similar to what's happening in Cranston, Rhode Island, one could say. So this is a case being heard in Massachusetts, and it's challenging the phrase under God in the Pledge of Allegiance, because in Massachusetts, teachers are required to start each day reciting the Pledge of Allegiance. And so, Todd, what's the twist on this case?
Well, the big twist is that most pledge cases in the past, I think all of them actually, were based on the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment of the Constitution. And we've lost every single one of those because the courts have ruled either that we don't have standing or that it's not establishing a religion. And the twist on this one is that it's an equal protection clause of the 14th Amendment claim. And essentially, that clause of the Constitution says that every person will be given equal protection under the laws by the states and the federal government. And the claim here is that people who are not specifically theistic, or in this case, monotheistic, are being discriminated against because they're being led in this prayer that is essentially something that completely goes against their beliefs. And therefore, it's discriminatory. They're not being equally protected, and it should be done away with. Right. Or even better, let's go back to the original version that didn't have under God. Because as probably most of our listeners know, the majority of the existence of the Pledge of Allegiance, it did not have the phrase under God in it. It was added during the Cold War as a reaction to godless communism, an overreaction, I'd say. It's essentially a relic of McCarthyism. Right. And I would love to see it go back to the original. And we're patriotic just like anyone else. I think that our issue here is the discrimination aspect and the monotheistic support from government. It is discriminatory. So it's a cool case. It's being led by AHA's president, David Nyosi, and it's a strategy he came up with, I believe, and it's kind of a cool slant. So we'll see how this goes. But they just had arguments up in Massachusetts in the Massachusetts Superior Court. And right. We'll see what happens.
So what David Nyosi is actually requesting is that the inclusive version of the Pledge of Allegiance, the one that was actually written in 1892 as being completely secular and inclusive for all Americans, he's asking that that version be used in schools, in this school, in this case.
Which makes sense because it was one nation indivisible, and now it's divided by the phrase under God.
Right.
Because
absolutely.
15% of Americans don't believe in any kind of, are not religious at all, let alone believing in, you know, specific deities and the like. So,
right. So this case actually was started a couple of years ago, November 2010. And there's sort of been some motion to dismiss and some back and forth. And
oh, of course.
So exactly. So, but most recently what happened earlier this month was that David Nyosi had the chance to give his arguments in the case. So David Nyosi is presenting this case on behalf of the Abagnani Humanist Legal Center. And you can always check out what's going on there at humanistlegalcenter.org. And of course, all of the links that we mentioned on today's show will be on the show notes page for this episode at thehumanisthour.org.
So one interesting way that this particular case is directly related in a way to what Jessica Alquist has been going through is because of the fact that in Rhode Island, they've actually been using the Pledge of Allegiance as a way to discriminate and as a way to attempt to justify an official school prayer, which was what the banner said. It said school prayer. And so I had the fortune of being able to meet Jessica a few months ago when I was in Boston, when I went up to see Seth MacFarlane. And Jessica was there, and I got a chance to talk to her and her family a little bit. And she told me that the day after the suit was filed, she was in class and they were reciting the pledge in Rhode Island, which is a different state from Massachusetts, but still they were reciting the pledge. And when they got to the phrase under God, her entire class turned to her and screamed at her, "Under God," like very angrily and aggressively. So, you know, if that's not an example that the phrase under God is discriminatory, it could be quoted exactly as is and used to discriminate against people who are not specifically Christian or not specifically religious. And it's happening right now. And so I think that's even more reason this case is particularly important. And, you know, I think as we see the pledge being used, the current version, the edited version of the pledge being used to discriminate against people, that provides even more grounds for going after equal protection. People, the government shouldn't be promoting and sponsoring things that are used to discriminate or make people feel like second-class citizens. So, and I believe, Jess, you actually had a little bit of an incident of that when you were in Cranston recording a few days ago.
I absolutely did, Todd. I mean, that sort of tone, that energy was certainly, it was very much there. So what I saw was certainly not a display of all those other characteristics that are listed on that prayer banner or that mural. So the desire to do our best and grow mentally, morally, and treating others and being good sports and smiling when we lose and also when we win and the value of friendship. I didn't necessarily see that from a lot of the comments, and you'll hear some of that. So what we're going to play for you next is, it's just sort of a little montage of the vibe that I got from being there, from the energy in the beginning for while people were waiting for the meeting to start, and just individual comments. And you can hear, you know, where people from both sides are coming from. And, you know, I'm certainly glad that I was there, that it happened, and that people were passionate enough to come out. And that's people on both sides. But in the end, I'm glad that the school board decided to do what was right. This committee meeting started with hearing from the lawyer who was giving his sort of perspective on this is what this case is about. And the way that he laid it out was that this is not a case that is about taking prayer out of school. That's what his sort of upfront thing was. And then he started talking about one of the biggest sort of concerns about what appealing would do to the school district, which is what's the financial burden that would come with this appeal.
Despite what a lot of people think, this is not about prayer in public school. Just so everyone knows, in 1962, the U.S. Supreme Court decided that there would be no more prayer in public school. Now, that was decided a long time ago. And a lot of people think that was wrong, but that's the law. This case was what we thought was a display case. The judge thought it was a prayer case. And one could say, because it says prayer, and then he made comments about Heavenly Father and Amen being Christian or not. We didn't argue. We knew we would lose if we argued that it was a prayer of any type, it was a universal prayer. We had to argue that it was a secular display. That's how we would win the display cases. That's how you win the display cases. The Supreme Court a few years ago, the U.S. Supreme Court, allowed the Ten Commandments to be in the Texas State House grounds because they found it was primarily secular. And they said no one had ever complained in the years it was up, and they thought it would be divisive if they took it down. We argued, no one has ever complained except this one time in 50 years. It was secular. It was never used as a prayer. And we think it would be divisive if you ordered to take it down. Now, So, what are the costs involved here, just so everyone knows? There's been a fee petition for $173,000 for the work that was done so far. Now, what is that based on? That's based on a statute passed by Congress that gives someone a right if they prevail in a civil rights case, and in this case it was ruled that the First Amendment was being violated, to get their counsel fees. So that's where that comes from. That's not damages to the plaintiff or anything, it's just counsel fees. We have the right to kind of fight about that petition if we want, but a lot of work was done, and frankly, I don't think it should be 173, but it's not going to be 50. The judge is going to give some money there. If we appeal and the city loses in the First Circuit, there'll be more fees automatically under the statute, provided that they're justified. If a decision is made, if you lose in the First Circuit, to go to the Supreme Court, as I just described, and you lose, more fees. So let me give you an idea of the magnitude of the money we're talking about. We've got a petition for 170. My estimate, based on 37 years of doing this, is that there would be fees of $75,000 to $100,000 to the First Circuit. If it went to the Supreme Court, there would be fees in the range of $200,000 or more. So what's facing the city, in my view, from a pure cost point of view, to run this up the ramp, hoping that the Supreme Court might take it as a display case, not as a prayer case, it would cost the risk of $500,000. That has nothing to do with paying the lawyers representing the city. That's not an issue. So that's where we are in the law. So Judge LaGura didn't decide that. That was decided a long time ago by our Supreme Court. So I could answer questions, but I can't do that. I hope I've covered some areas for you and set the tone and set the table for what the issues are that confront this committee. Thank you.
Now, in that same, like literally 2 minutes later, not even, like almost the next person that was speaking was a member of this school committee who was making this decision. And she was saying that, you know, because we don't usually have this many people here, you know, when we're doing our budgeting meetings, we're going to take advantage of the fact that we've got nearly 400 people in this room. And we're just going to let you know that as you walked in, you walked by a bake sale, we're raising money because we had to yank music programming out of one of our lower schools. And so I'm thankful. As she was saying it, I was like, what? Like, what's happening? Like, why is she talking about that right now? But I'm thankful in hindsight that she did, because I'm sure that there are parents there saying, wait a second. Like, you're telling me that the school district is going to have to fork up almost $500,000, maybe $1 million. And then you're telling me that we're yanking programs because we don't have the money. Like, that doesn't make sense. So
imagine what programs get cut if they keep spending.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And not like they're going to win. I mean, the odds would be strongly against them. And once you've lost at the lower level, and there's pretty strong, I mean, I'm not an attorney, but as far as I know, there's pretty strong case law against official government prayers.
Yeah. And this, the judge was very clear and pretty adamant. And he was like, it was not a hard case. It is pretty cut and dry.
Yeah.
So
as well, it should be.
Yeah.
It's interesting, you know, this is actually happening all over the place, both at schools and, you know, counties and districts, where you've got governments and oftentimes you've got the politicians representing a very radical portion of the population who's pretty small. There's like a small part of the population who's very radical, really wants to have a Christian nation, really wants a theocracy. And these politicians pander them and end up costing taxpayers millions of dollars across the country every year fighting cases trying to force religion on people. It's kind of sad.
Yeah. Yeah.
Terrible use of resources.
Absolutely. And parents were very vocal about that. And so you'll hear from some of them.
A few months ago, I stood right in front of this very building with many of the people in this room and proclaimed that I am Cranston. I had stickers all over me that said that I was a taxpayer, I was a parent, and that I was an alumni, which I am. I'm very proud of that. And I did it because I wanted to support our schools. I ask you not to proceed with the appeal. I ask you to make a hard decision. It may not be the popular decision. Well, at least that's what I originally wrote. But I've been keeping a tally of how many people have walked up here as a Cranston resident. And we're dead even right now as to how many of us agree with an appeal or do not agree with an appeal. But I've seen you make those hard decisions before. And I ask you to make another choice that, again, may or may not at this point be the popular choice. But our schools and our children cannot afford to have any more funds taken away from them. We need you to move forward. We need the schools to move forward. And we need you to please not appeal this. Thank you. Thank you. I'm speaking wholeheartedly against this appeal. I have three simple reasons. First of all, it makes no sense. This matter of constitutional law has been decided and decided long ago. This is, with all due respect, Attorney Kavanaugh, a matter of prayer in school, in my opinion. You will be wasting time and incredible resources, $500,000. How dare you? I really, really wonder, how dare you do that in light of all that you need to be paying attention to? Which brings me to reason two. The school committee has far better and more important things that are truly in your mandate. You must work on our children's math scores. You must care about preparing our students for jobs in this new and difficult economy. You must care about doing more with less funds. You must devote as much time and energy as possible to these and many more pressing issues. And I must say that I do appreciate your work. I know that you all work many, many long hours, and I thank you for that. The last reason I have for you is that because I'm old, I was a child when prayer was still happening in schools. I was a public school student, grade two, as I recall, in North Reading, Massachusetts, where I'm from. And I remember feeling brokenhearted that my teacher was saying a version of the Lord's Prayer every single day that wasn't the same one that I said. Because how could I decide? I loved my teacher. How could I decide which was right? That is the establishment of religion. It's not an establishment of religion that says, little girl, you have to believe in my religion. It's an establishment of religion that says, 30 seconds, I'm your teacher, and I know I'm telling you the things that are right, and you must listen to me, and yet she doesn't believe if I do. It was wrong then, and I'm grateful that the Supreme Court changed this ruling and made this ruling about school prayer. And finally, my kids came here. If there had been a prayer banner in this school, I would have been so proud if one of them decided to do what Jessica did, and I'd say thank you.
One of my favorite statements was, it was a mother who was saying, like in as humans, like we've got the head, we've got the heart, and we've got the spirit. And there's a place for each one of those things. We've got the school for the head, we've got the home for the heart, and we've got church for the spirit. There's no need to bring them together.
I'm not wearing an appeal sign. What must that mean? I believe the separation of church and state is important much in the way that I believe in the wisdom of three branches of government. Now, there is the heart, the head, and the spirit, and they each have their place, home, school, and church. I believe there is a place for this mural, but it is in another place where those who subscribe to its sentiment can appreciate it. The concept of God is not one on which we can all agree, and has been the subject of much love and debate. I'm sure since the very first person came up with one. We can, however, agree on the alphabet, numerals, the rules of gravity, and dodgeball. And by the way, my last comment is any additional dollar that this school system spends on this case rather than on a decent education for
Thank
my
you.
Children is Susan. An outrage.
I wish more people had that attitude.
Yeah, me too. There was also one of my personal favorites. This man, I was sort of keeping a tally of people who were for the appeal and against the appeal. This man happened to be for the appeal. And he was talking about how he sort of hated the people who were working on Jessica's behalf, the ACLU, and just listen to what he called the ACLU.
Ladies and gentlemen of the school committee, we are faced with a terrible, terrible cancer that is going through our nation. The cancer is the ACLU.
So I mentioned that I thought that some of these people were sort of ignorant, and also it made me sad because you would hear someone who was against the appeal say something like, all we're asking is for every person's belief to be respected. That's it. Like, everyone's belief or not, like, treat people equally, treat people fairly. And, you know, the people who were against the appeal clapped, which was like maybe 15 or 20 of us, less than 100 for sure. And then you'd hear someone say, there's a cancer in this country that is the ACLU, and they go wild.
This banner has been at Cranston West since 1963. This banner shows the students an encouraging goal that they should achieve. This is our constitutional right for this banner to stay up. We, the people, urge you, please, to appeal this decision. Because this is a virus, it won't stop. If we don't stop this now, these people, the ACLU, these people that are tearing us down, okay? We need to fight for what is right. This is what is right. Please, I urge you, okay, to appeal this decision. Thank you.
Let me say this. Let me start out with this. I think the policemen should probably arrest everybody in this office, everybody in this auditorium. This is a public building with public money, and we said in God we trust, we pledged the allegiance with the name God in there. So that's what's coming down the pike. And if you don't believe me, you haven't done the research that I have done for the last 2 weeks. Throughout this country, not just in Cranston, not just in Rhode Island, piece by piece by piece, the ACLU, the atheists, the libertarians, and they're all part of the same cabal. I have read their writings. They have said, we will use the Constitution of the United States of America to make it a secular, a social country. I have been interviewed by many, many people, and they said to me, you're not a native of Cranston. What's your issue? Why are you involved? My answer, I am a citizen of the United States of America.
Those same people can't clap for someone saying, treat people with everyone with respect. Like, isn't that a foundation, like a core value of your religion anyway? It's a core value listed on that banner. Like, I don't understand.
Right. It's a core value of most religious people and most humanists as well. But once you get into this fundamentalism, you get these people all wild up about trying to, you know, make themselves feel better and justified about their beliefs. If the government backs it up, then my belief must be right. I guess it must be some part of the psychological mechanism here. And yeah, you start getting them doing crazy things that are just disgraceful to themselves and really do a whole disservice to their communities. The irony, of course, is that the vast majority of ACLU clients, I would bet, are Christians. I'm sure it's a very small minority that are Jews or Muslims or atheists. Yes. You know, it's oftentimes the Christians who are having to be defended for various reasons. And, you know, but some people are pretty narrow-minded.
Right. But I mean, I have to admit also there were some people who were against the appeal who were religious also. And so it was neat to hear their perspective.
Yeah.
And because it just makes sense. It makes legal sense. It makes sense financially. It makes sense. So that was nice to hear.
I am the son of Irish Catholic immigrants. I grew up in a family where we said the rosary every day. Today, I said the rosary with a dying friend. So I'm a believing, practicing Christian. And it's out of that Irish Catholic tradition that I want to support Jessica. My Irish immigrant parents sacrificed to build parochial schools because they felt the public schools, the prayers that were said, the Bible that was read there, did not respect them and their religion. I don't think we should, I don't want my tax dollars spent promoting a system that favors one religion over another. Thank you very much.
I graduated this school in 1971, and I'm going to quote a gentleman who was one of my fellow classmates that I wasn't friendly with at the time, and I have since befriended on Facebook. Well, he finally saw the thing, and he got on, and he said, "Look, I'm a rabbi. Hello?" He says, I'm really into prayer. It's my job. I really want people to pray." He said, "But it doesn't belong on the school wall." And he recommended a prayer similar to the thing here, which expressed the same sentiments, but without addressing it to God. And the other thing he said that I thought was really, really interesting, he said, "I'm not a Christian," he said, "but I do know the Christian story, and I suggest that the people involved in this incident look to the early Christians and what they did when they wanted to learn how to pray." He said, "They did not go to the Jerusalem School Committee and say, 'Do you have a prayer for us?' And they did not go to the Roman Emperor and say, 'How do we pray?' And they did not go to their local public school." He said, "They went to Jesus and said, 'Teach us to pray.'" He said, "So I recommend that that's what the people involved here do." He said, "You don't go to your government or your public school or your school committee and get a prayer from them that they hang on the wall for you." That's better than I can put it.
And I think we should judge people by what they do and not by what they believe. We all know there are lovely religious people, horrible religious people, lovely atheists, horrible atheists, and everything else you can think of. And I'm just sick and tired of this stuff. And I think I know how you guys are going to vote, and I'd be surprised, I've been wrong before, but I'd be surprised if you don't. And, I think that that is the right way to vote. You got to stop, or you're going to hemorrhage money, because you just can't win. And that's it. I'll just cut it off early. Thank you.
So listeners, that was what Jes recorded just a couple of days ago at the meeting where they decided not to appeal the decision where Jessica won. And so the prayer banner will be coming down, but I will leave it to you to decide if the people at that meeting were worried more about prayer and forcing their religion on other people, or worried more about the message that was contained in the prayer. Because interestingly, the message was actually good if it was put up in a way that was not sectarian or not specifically religious. But I wonder if they were really living by the morals that were being taught on that, or just fighting to try to discriminate and enforce their will on others. So here's a little quote. And were they living by this? Were they doing something that was, quote, "to be kind and helpful to our classmates and teachers? And did they, quote, conduct ourselves so as to bring credit to Cranston High School West? Amen."
So now they're looking for a new home for this banner. And some people suggested that you just edit it, or you hang up a secular version of it. And there's some sentimental value to it, and there's some history. And so they don't want to get rid of it. So how do they honor that history but also honor the Constitution?
Great. Put it in a church. Put it on private property somewhere. It's very appropriate there. Great. Awesome.
Right.
Heck, if they want to put up a secular banner, my foundation will pay for it. I'm fine with that.
Yeah, that's cool. So I had the opportunity to just sort of, I walked up to the back row and I sat down next to Ellery Schempp, and I just sort of shook his hand because I just love him to pieces. He's a sweet man and a brave man. And I felt bad almost, because I was like, it makes me sad that because he already did this. He was responsible for having prayer removed from public school. And that was in his case, which was Abington School District versus Schempp.
And I think something important to clarify here is it's not that the Supreme Court ruled that prayer is not allowed in school. And it's not that the prayer that's listed on the banner at Cranston High School, Cranston West High School, is not allowed. It's what the Supreme Court has ruled and other courts have ruled is that the government can't sponsor these prayers. The government can't sanction them, require them, post them, encourage them, etc. The students have every right to pray if they want to. They can pray in their own heads. They can pray out loud. They can do what they want. They have a freedom of speech, you know, within this certain bounds. They probably can't do it mid-class, but if they want to do it during the hallway, they've got that right. And the ACLU would step in instantly if somebody was being repressed from being allowed to pray individually.
Exactly.
It's government-sponsored prayer, government-sponsored religion that is not legal in this country for very, very good reasons. It's to protect it's mostly to protect the religious people. That was why they put it in place in the first place. You know, they don't want their governments forcing certain sects of Christianity or other religions upon other people. So, you know, yeah, this case has been fought before and won. And yeah, Ellery Schempp was, you know, one of the first right there.
Yeah. So it was kind of heartwarming and kind of sad for me that he was there. But I thought he's been very active in this case, and he's reached out to Jessica numerous times. And I just think that it's pretty amazing that they're sort of two different generations of fighting a very similar, if not the same, battle.
Good news is we're winning.
Yeah. Yep.
And if you're listening, Jessica Ellery, I'm personally really thankful for what you've done for me and for the whole country and for mankind, because this kind of thing is protecting all of us.
Yep.
Thank you.
Absolutely. So I had the privilege of sitting with some folks from the Rhode Island atheist meetup group, and also from some folks from the Harvard humanist community. And I was telling them that we were waiting for Ellery to speak, but they only allowed for 2 hours of hearing residents and teachers and things like that. And they started with people who are the most directly affected, so local residents. And so Ellery didn't actually get to get up and give remarks about his experience and his thoughts on the current situation. So, but what I thought that we could do is, several years ago, we were fortunate that Ellery Schempp came to visit us at the studio in Albany, New York, and we were able to record the conversation about what his experience was like back in 1963 during the United States Supreme Court case. And so I wanted to play that now so that listeners could hear and maybe find some similarities, or maybe find, I don't know, I just think it's a great fit.
So what's pretty cool about this is a deep vault entry. It's actually not available online in our archives or anywhere else at this point in time. So this is something we are pulling out of the hidden vaults to share with you. And of course, will be available on our archives after today as part of this episode.
Absolutely. So here is Ellery Schempp.
Ellery, can you tell us what you did 50 years ago on November the 26th, 1956?
Well, on that day, I made a protest at school about the practice of Bible reading and the recitation of the Lord's Prayer. And I did this by not paying attention during Bible reading. And in fact, what I did is brought a copy of the Koran. I read that sitting at my desk quietly to myself, of course. And I only chose the Koran because it was available. It could have been the Bhagavad Gita or something, but I just wanted to show that there were other holy books in the Bible. And I didn't stand up for the Lord's Prayer, and that became rather obvious, I suppose. And I jumped to my feet and did the flag salute. And of course, I was, my homeroom teacher was rather shocked. I was a junior in high school in suburban Philadelphia in Abington Township at that time. So he sent me to the principal, and the principal was also rather shocked because I wasn't one of those kids who got in trouble all the time. I was told that I should, obey the school rules, and I came home that afternoon and evening, talked to my folks, and told them what had happened. And I sat down and I wrote a letter to the American Civil Liberties Union, the ACLU in Philadelphia. And in that letter, I simply asked if they would be interested in helping what I considered to be a violation of the First Amendment principles, and sent it off with a $10 bill, which turned out to be significant because the ACLU was feeling poor, and they thought it was very nice that a 16-year-old boy would be able to save up enough money to include $10. And that was 1956 money, so $10 was worth a bit.
Now, what was the upshot of that letter?
After, I think about 6 months, the ACLU voted to take on the Bible reading cases.
Now, it sounds like your parents were very supportive of you at this time.
Well, it was absolutely essential that my parents were supportive because 16-year-olds don't have the right to bring any cases to court. And so the case had to be filed by my parents in the name of their three children, myself, my younger brother Roger, and my younger sister, Donna. This is one reason why the case actually succeeded getting all the way to the Supreme Court, because it was essential that I had that there was somebody who was still affected by the law. Under the U.S. Law, you can't bring a case in the abstract. There has to be somebody who was actually being affected by the law that you're challenging. And up to the time of the final hearing before the Supreme Court, which was in February of 1963, so fortunately my siblings were still in school at that time. Otherwise, the case would have been called moot, that is, no longer of legal relevance. And it was so essential that I grew up in a family where I knew about the existence of the ACLU.
Right. Well, it's great to have a supportive family, but what about the other kids at the school and the community in general?
Well, two years later, I graduated and went off to college. Roger and Donna were harassed a little bit at school. Roger was pushed and shoved around a couple times. Donna was mortified. She was the one, I think, who really felt the pressure most. Even to this day, she somehow feels a sense of embarrassment about it, although she agrees entirely intellectually that she has, I guess you might call it an emotional scar.
Now, what happened when the case got to the Supreme Court?
Since we had won at the district court level, we won twice, as it turns out, because the Pennsylvania legislature changed the law a little bit, and the Supreme Court the first time decided that it should be reheard in the light of the changed law. So the Supreme Court agreed to take it in the fall of 1962, and the hearing was in February of 1963, and the final decision was rendered on June 17th of 1963.
A lot of people credit or perhaps blame Madeleine Murray O'Hare for taking prayer out of public schools. What was her involvement in this case?
Well, her case began entirely independently. Our first hearing was on August 5th of 1958 at the district court in Philadelphia. And I happen to remember that because that happened to be my birthday. And I testified on the stand, and so did my parents, and so did Roger and Donna, about the nature of the practices and what our objections were. But Madeleine Murray's case began in Baltimore. Her first hearing was in 1960. Her case went up through the state courts, from the Baltimore Municipal Court up through the Supreme Court of Maryland. And from that, and she had been on the losing side, so she appealed to the Supreme Court. In October or so of 1962, the Supreme Court agreed to hear both cases, and they decided that the cases presented substantially the same issue. So they decided that the entire case would be heard at once, and that case would be called Abington, School District of Abington versus Schempp, and Murray versus Curlett.
So
one decision for both cases.
Right. And do you feel that the case would have been won for either of them, if your case had gone ahead without hers, or indeed hers had gone ahead without yours?
I think so. I mean, we had very, very strong opinions from the federal district court. When we first won, the court rendered an opinion that said that the practice of reading 10 verses of the Holy Bible at the beginning of each school day in Pennsylvania was a clear violation of the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment. And because in the original law there was no provision for a child to be excused from it, it also violated the free exercise clause. So that was a very, very powerful decision. And even after the law was amended to allow a child to be excused, and that's why there was a second hearing, the court said that it's still a violation of the Establishment Clause, and we're not even convinced that allowing a child to be excused solves the problem of free exercise, because how would a child actually be exempted from it by going and standing in the hall, or anyhow it would require the child to make some kind of self-identification of being a dissenter or non-believer or something. So anyhow, we had those powerful decisions. Now, Madeleine Murray, she had her own powerful arguments, but she had actually lost in the courts. But I thought it was good for the Supreme Court to see that different kinds of religious background could have the same objection. I mean, we were members of a Unitarian church. Madeleine Murray was a pronounced atheist, of course. Unitarians are very free-thinking, and they range all the way from having Christian believers to atheists and humanists among the UUs. But nonetheless, the fact that we were members of a church, nobody knew what a Unitarian church was, but it had that magic word church in it, you see, that gave us an awful lot of protection.
You're listening to an interview with Matt Cherry and Ellery Schempp. 50 years ago, Ellery was responsible for the landmark U.S. Supreme Court case, which declared that public school-sanctioned Bible readings were unconstitutional. In the next portion of the interview, you're going to hear about how Madeline Murray O'Hare was involved in this case as well. And keep in mind as you listen that when Ellery refers to the Schempp family, he's talking about his own family.
So how did you, and I guess your parents, feel about Madeline getting so much of the limelight afterwards, and also getting so much of the blame, because she really became a lightning rod that people blamed for taking religion out of our schools?
Well, first of all, we had no objection, but actually I was no objection to her getting a lot of attention. She was actually described by Time magazine as the most hated woman in America. One of the things that we learned, we got about 5,000 letters, and they broke into fairly neatly into thirds. About a third were supportive, about two-thirds were against us. But thing that about the two-thirds against us, they also split in half. And one-third were reasonable men could differ, and these usually had return addresses, and my folks actually replied to them, to everyone that had a return address. The final third, of course, was just full of hate, vituperative and just really nasty. Some of them included excrement, whatever. But the thing that we really learned was that we were accused of being everything the writer disliked. We would get letters that said, "What are you, Jews? What are you, niggers? What are you, Catholics? What are you, Nazis? What are you, communists?" And after about 100 or so of these, you just wonder about this kind of irrational hatred. But we did see one thing. It was bad to be a Nazi. It was very, very bad to be a communist. But it was really awful to be an atheist. And when people called us, "you communist atheist," they shot their wad. They didn't know any, they couldn't think of anything worse to call us. So we learned that atheists are the most hated group in America. And I think this is very sad. And it was because Madeline Murray was an outspoken atheist. That's why so much hate went to her.
Right. Now, did you have much?
It was really quite terrible what happened to her in Baltimore. I mean, I could only liken it to that of the situation of a civil rights worker in Mississippi in the bad old days. Her kids were beaten up on the way home from school many times. They would miss a day, and then when they had to go back, they would find the entire system was against them. Teachers would say, "Oh, you missed a math exam, you missed an English essay, you missed a history quiz, you missed this, right? You missed 3 days worth of homework," and they were penalized every which way. And when their house was firebombed, the fire department took a particularly circuitous route to get there so that they would get there late and all that sort of thing. So she suffered tremendously, and we did not.
Right. And it didn't stop her. I mean, she kept on campaigning, even though she had to move to different cities and persecution.
Absolutely. And in fact, the reason that she eventually left Baltimore was because there was a trumped-up charge against her for resisting arrest and for assaulting a police officer. And it all happened when the police came on one occasion. I don't know what it was at that point. But Madeline had an elderly mother. She was 85 or something. And apparently tried to hit the policeman over the head with a frying pan. and they took that incident and, you know, tried to make a federal case out of it.
Now, it's been almost 50 years since the Supreme Court decided that we couldn't have prayers or teacher-led prayers in public schools. What do you think are the consequences of that momentous change 50 years ago?
I think the schools are better off for this, and children in the schools are better off for this as a result of this, because the notion of having a Christian religious practice in the schools shows a kind of government favoritism towards the Bible, for example, as opposed to other holy books, and shows a favoritism towards Christian prayers as opposed to non-religious people. And I think that and I think the religion has of course it has an important role to play in many people's lives, but I think the schools are supposed to be neutral zones, and the function of schools is for learning, for education, for kids learning about the world around us. And when you have these kinds of overt religious practices, then that sort of tilts the way kids would understand the world, for example. I mean, there's many things about Bible beliefs and Noah's flood and various things that are contradictory to science. And, you know, there's efforts nowadays to put in so-called intelligent design or creationism into the public schools. And I think that having a religious practice would only encourage that kind of thing. And I also, I objected to the Bible reading for several reasons, but one of the main ones was it seemed to me to be really unfair. I mean, the Bible, as I said, is not the holy book for the Buddhists or Hindus or Muslims. And I saw that my Jewish friends were sort of cringing when Easter and Christmas stories were read. And I thought that since we have the First Amendment, and I thought there was a very clear understanding of what the Founding Fathers intended about separation of government and religion, I thought it showed disrespect for the First Amendment and for the Constitution in general for the schools to be promoting something that was clearly in violation. So I thought that that the decision was a very important one, and I'm very happy for it.
I mean, I think the decision was a great rallying cry for the religious right too. I mean, before we had Roe versus Wade, and now we have a big controversy over same-sex marriage. But before those issues, the religious right did a lot of fundraising, a lot of organizing, a lot of political campaigning based on trying to get prayer back into schools. Do you feel that the religious right has been stronger than you expected back then, that they've lasted longer, and it's still surprising that this is controversial even 50 years later?
I am disappointed that it's still controversial 50 years later. It's sort of interesting that initially there was a huge outcry, and it was clearly unpopular in many parts of the United States. It's still a little bit interesting that about 30 states had some kind of Bible reading and prayer practices in the schools. Mostly were in the South and the North, Northeast. And as you went further west, fewer and fewer states and schools had these practices. But at any rate, many people were kind of outraged because they had this notion that somehow prayer is helpful to kids. Well, this is a religious view, of course, that I don't share. And as I said, I still think it was good for the schools to have to be in a neutral position. Anyhow, initially there was attempts to have Congress pass a constitutional amendment to overturn the court's decision, but that failed to get a two-thirds majority. And then the issue, and it failed actually for a rather interesting reason, not so much because atheists and humanists and Unitarian Universalists and ethical culture continued to uphold the Supreme Court's view on this matter, but because organized religion, the National Council of Christian Churches, came to testify eventually that they thought that religion by rote was a cheapening of religion, and they thought that that separation of church and state was good for religion as well as for the government. So it was actually the voices of the mainstream Christian denominations that I think prevented the amendment from passing. But anyhow, after that initial attempt, the issue kind of died down. I mean, there were certainly groups that kept agitating for it. The last serious effort to amend the Constitution was during the Ronald Reagan administration, but that also failed to get a two-thirds vote out of the Congress. And interestingly enough, it is actually not as as high on the agenda of the religious right today as you might think. They're going after issues such as teaching intelligent design or teaching abstinence and in terms of sex education and all sorts of other things. And so the issue of prayer in the public schools, I think maybe they have given up on, or maybe they have come to realize that it is a basically unfair kind of notion. In addition, of course, the Supreme Court did not, as I say, as Senator Eastland said, put the niggers in school and thrown God out. But the Supreme Court did not throw the Bible out of the public schools. It's what it said is that you can't have a ceremonial, devotional kind of exercise around religion. But if you want to teach religion as literature, or teach the Bible as literature, or even as history, or if you want to have a class in which you teach about religion, in which you treat all religions fairly, that's entirely constitutional, and like, I would encourage it. I think more kids should learn about the different religions of the world.
I want to thank you for the groundbreaking work that you did in helping to separate church and state and create a more secular environment for our school children and for all Americans.
Well, I thank you very much for those kind remarks, and I'd like to remind people that it wasn't just me, that it couldn't have happened without the support of my parents and family, and certainly not without the support of the ACLU.
That was a Humanist Hour archived interview with Matt Cherry and Ellery Schempp. 50 years ago, Ellery was involved in that landmark case which declared government-sanctioned Bible readings unconstitutional. Ellery's from Boston, where he continues to be a dedicated Unitarian Universalist as well as an avid supporter of the ACLU.
Well, listeners, we also have something pretty cool to announce, which is we are going to have a new home. We are going to be able to be found through AHA still, but we are also going to be on Pathos.com as the Humanist podcast that they will have on their site, which is pretty neat.
Yeah, it's awesome. So Pathos is this website that promotes sort of just seeking and understanding all beliefs, all life stances, so all different religions and atheism alike. And so what they've done is they've created a portal for each of those major religions and also an atheist portal. And they're highlighting some blogs. So you can currently already see Royce Beckert has a blog up there. The Friendly Atheist is up there. And they want to highlight the Humanist Hour as the sort of official podcast for atheism, which is pretty cool. So check it out, pathos.com/blogs/the Humanist Hour. And of course, you can find that link on the show notes page for this episode at thehumanisthour.org.
You could find our previous episodes and show notes at thehumanisthour.org. You can also like us on Facebook, please. And you can call our listener comment line, which has been a little quiet lately, listeners. Please give us a call. Let us know what you're thinking. Let us know what you think of the show and any comments, thoughts you have, or ideas, which you can reach us at 202-618-1371. All right, Jess. Well, thanks for another fun episode. I look forward to talking next month, and also looking forward to the Reason Rally. Everybody be there March 24th, Washington, D.C.
Listeners, can't wait to meet you. Can't wait to hopefully talk to some of you guys.
Yeah, we'll be there.
All right. Well, thanks for listening to The Humanist Hour. I'm Jess Constantine.
I'm Todd Stiefel.